the panelists, please, before you ask your question, wait until the microphone arrives at your place, because we are taking the entire proceedings.
Yes, when you discuss global warming, and you said at the beginning you weren't going to discuss the scientific evidence, yes, I think you did a wonderful job. But I'd like to recommend to everyone here, if they're not familiar with it, a cover article in Newsweek, 1975, The Cooling World, in which it pointed out that the Earth, which was a fact that can get progressively cooler for decades, up to 1975, this was certainly going to cause a cataclysm, and the governments of the Earth were too cowardly to take action to combat the cooling world. So I recommend that to everyone. You can easily look it up on Google, type in Newsweek, the Cooling World, April 28, 1975.
Yeah. Two very quick comments. The first one is that environmentalists apparently run out of fantasy because both the topic movie of the global cooling scam and the topic movie of the global warming scam is basically the same title. In fact, the first in the 70s, the symbol in the movie industry was the day after. And today, the symbol of the global warming fight is the day after tomorrow. Maybe when we will have the next come, the movie will be the next week, I don't know. But the most serious talk about this is that, now, if you accept the mainstream approach to this kind of issues, you will arrive to this unbelievable conclusion that since today, so we have said that global warming will make the world in a, will take the world in a worse position, and so we got to pay people for not consuming, basically, in order to prevent higher temperatures. And we were also told in the 70s that cooler temperatures were bad. It means that we are exactly in the optimum temperature now. So we should design policy in a way that we pay people for not consuming when temperature goes up, and we should pay people for consuming more when the temperature goes down in order to keep the temperatures as they are, which seems the perfect situation we have market phase or whatever it does.
Yes, I'd like to ask André Lichtschlag about the 110,000 criminal prosecutions for political offenses in Germany from 1994 to 2004. Could you describe, I wasn't aware of this, it sounds horrendous. Could you describe what types of political opinion offenses these were, and give us a little bit more of a picture?
Yes, it includes pictures, it includes, of course, the anarcho-capitalism. If you, with a pencil, you are pointing the wall.
Categories of these opinion offenses that have been prosecuted.
And it includes, of course, music, for example. It includes pictures, it includes to use the right arm above. And it includes to deny the Holocaust, of course. These things.
So mostly related to Nazism?
Yes.
I see.
It's not yet global warming.
You've included the homeschooler prosecutions as...
No, it's not included. Okay. It's an extra few. These statistics.
Yes.
Of course, homeschoolers, it's not easy to be a homeschooler in Germany.
Impossible.
Yes, you can try it, and you have very much problems. Perhaps you will be, and perhaps your children will be
capitalism.
Question from
Paul. May I just add something to this last question? If you paint a hunting device on the wall and you want to make sure that you don't go to jail for this, you just have to say that you tried to sign the Soviet, you know, this hammer thing on the wall, and you are not very clever in painting, you have no problem with that. I've just come from Italy and I brought you all something to give you an impression of political correctness, because I knew André was talking about this. I found something a few years ago in Italy that looks like that. This is cigarettes. I don't know if you can see this. It's, the name of these cigarettes is Nazionale. I think you can tell people to put it like this. And it has this N-A-Z-E. I. It is, you see the colors, I mean, it's very dangerous colors. I would not smoke these cigarettes in Germany because people, at least this is very
Sorry.
Yeah. On the other hand, in Austria, we have Austrian gas fields, you can go and buy cigarettes. Called Che, and you have the face of Che Guevara on it, and it's completely without any problem to smoke Che anywhere in Germany. So this gives you an impression of how small discrimination is in Germany.
If I also may add one very brief one to this, to create the, some bit of craziness, you should let people know that Che Guevara was actually fascist. If you look at the kind of policies he had in mind and the kind of policies that he had under the fascism. So, in a way, it fits us. Mm-hmm. And we have one point also. As I said, the Che Guevara don't seem to depend on what you're saying, but the book says it. And it's the same with its hunger codes. I've written my name in the hunger codes, maybe a very problematic for me. They do it very often with the articles in the other people in the magazine. However, it's no profit for them because it's a leftist magazine and it's not profit.
Question related to the issue, to which extent do you think that this completely correct anti-fascism is a spontaneous expression of a mindset, and to which extent is it actually orchestrated, planned, and organized and carried through? To which extent do other groups and national socialists have been affected by incorrect accounts of propaganda or actions or physical violence?
Yeah,
Hans-Hermann.
As I said, I think the main group target is, of course, the Nazis. And I think step by step now, other content fields are implemented, but by law, by these laws, as I said, we go to jail. I think these fields in Germany so far are if you are Nazi, not if you are terrorist or something. Let me add one interesting point. When I talk in Germany about political correctness, usually the main audience who is no leftist says, okay, political correctness exists, and okay, it's a little problem, but not for me, because I will not go to talk show and do civil order. And then there are leftists, of course, they say, okay, political correctness exists, but and it's good that it exists. And I think there are two more groups which are very interesting. And the one group, I think it's libertarians in Germany. And, the kind of libertarians that are not members of the property and freedom society. These people say, oh, there doesn't exist political correctness at all. There is no such thing as that. for the employment, besides these laws, besides this jail sentences. And I think these people, they have no feeling for this, that there exists a kind of pre-protest or a kind of informal politics. And then there is a fourth group. And the fourth group is people who live under communism, really live under communism. And these groups, these people say, yes, it exists, and it's an awful sign that the society went to totalitarian. I think this is interesting.
In my opinion, after 22 years in Germany, is that all the politicians in Germany see themselves as kind of human engineers. I really have the impression, and some people even claim this, they want to create a new human being. They want to create new men. Like, what they think a better man, I don't know. The thing is, we have to be arguments there.
Once we get an economist and teach economics, one of my colleagues used this apparatus in his classroom called the ISLM curve, the geometric exposition of Keynesian economics, all sorts of square lines. And a Jewish student of his complained to the administration that it looked like a swastika. And he was fearful for his job. They took him in and made him go through re-education training and sensitivity training. But a question for André, this idea of apologizing for politically incorrect thoughts, I'm interested in that. I observed that in American academia for about 20 years, where the leftists won't debate you, they will demand you apologize your existence. And I was wondering if you knew something about the genesis of this tactic, where it comes from, whose idea it might have been, or maybe you don't know. I just thought you might have some understanding of that.
So where it comes from, I said, I think it was policy in Maoist China.
Culture again.
because Mao had a criminal law. This criminal law, of course, it was forbidden to say absurd things. He who says absurd things was punished. And so maybe, and this is what I like from Professor Hubbard this morning, when he said, let's have fun. Maybe the way out is to say absurd things into the faces of all these people. And coming back again to the German situation, I can quote, and that's what I do in my lectures, I quote from the National Socialist Party program from 1920. That's point number 20, and it says, poor people have their children, and if these children are intelligent, the state should take them away from the family and educate them to make them good members of society in economics. And this was National Socialist Party program. And in 1949, 29 years later, the GBR constitution said simply the same again. So you have what Carlo said, Che Guevara was a fascist, of course. This is one and the same. Left is right and right is left. Then I meet
and both are wrong.
And both are wrong, of course. Thank you to make this clear. Also, all the cameras, both are wrong. And now a social democrat has written a book last year. He claims to be a specialist for health care questions. And this guy, his name is not important enough to be quoted, he wrote a book and he says exactly the same what, as I told you, was the National Socialist Program for Families and what was the GDR program. And he writes the same in his book. And the Stiegler and all these guys, they celebrate him as one who can take us out of the situation of the little children being intelligent, having poor people and poor parents and not getting out of their situation. And if you just hold the mirror onto this society and you tell them that this is what is happening again as a way into totalitarianism, they might find this absurd, but it tells them something. And if I may have two other sentences which seem very important for me for what is sort of seen on the ceiling today or on the wall today, from the climate change thing, there is an apparatus who wants to create some causalities between CO2 and the climate, and from one point, these attempts to make explanations are so crazy, just like in the beginning of the 16th century when the guy went around and said, if you put your coins into this box, your soul jumps into heaven. And this is the moment for people to tell the truth and to spread enlightenment and do what Carlo does, just to translate the Bible, you know, to explain counts. And then suddenly you are not a tiny little minority, but you are the beginning of a great new age of thinking and really thinking people. That's what I hope. That's why I'm here today.
About 2 years ago, when the conservative, when the neocons came to power in Romania, one of their acts of the parliament was to officially condemn the communist regime in Romania. Now, under, let's say, the Christian Democratic Union in Germany, would it be such a movement for the German parliament to condemn the communist regime in Germany?
No.
And why not? Given that Nazism was condemned, so.
Because Nazism is its own category. You can't compare it. You are allowed to compare it.
Absolutely.
You don't have to ask for to talk about this. It's clear for everyone. You learn in school the influence of Nazism. There can be no excitement.
I was interested in you mentioned that proposal that children be taken away from their parents, that society can form them in the way it wants. That appears actually during 4th century BC in Plato's Republic. which is the first detailed extent exposition of a totalitarian society. Guido says you should do that. It's an obvious desire of totalitarianism. It's interesting that both the communists and the Nazis claim Plato as their intellectual predecessor.
Your remarks suggested that you think that the public health system should be producing more sickness than health. Do you think this holds true in a narrow physiological sense, that if the health system, together with all the hospitals, disappeared, you would actually see the average health of citizens rise? And take aside emergency treatment, I'd say, do you think we've reached a point where people entering hospitals on average leave them less healthy than they went in? Very much the same way. Students entering public universities leave them more stupid.
I think I would go so far, but I dare to say that the health system does not correlate to the status of health of my fellow citizens. Both have nothing in common. It's just a way that the Minister of Health in Germany, Mrs. Schmidt, she's a communist. She was starting as a communist in the 70s, and then in 1983, she became a social democrat, and I almost mentioned waking up, and I mean, she can't shave herself in the morning, but she thought herself in the bathroom to the top of the morning in the river of Chicago. I'm a social democrat and no longer a communist. And then she wants a parliament, and what she does is simply she wants to have power and might over the people. And what we see now, and this is again why we can't condemn the GDR's history, what we see today is the politics of Mrs. Schmidt getting rid of single doctors in the country and putting them together in holding clinics and making industrial medical health care. And the pattern is just the same like in the GDR with owners of houses. You know, owners of houses, of private owners of houses who are not allowed to have their houses, but the state can come and take take it away. But the state said you can take rent of 13 marks, Eastern marks, and if something is wrong in the house, you have to pay it. It's still the owner, but you can put a lot of the money you needed to pay for it. And in the end, the state came and said, just like an Italian, maybe, proposed you can't say no to her. And said, I'll take over this house and you don't have any problems. And this is the same, this is today happening to Germany with single doctors. They are not within the system. They do not get paid appropriately, and they lose their jobs, they lose their lives, at least their economic lives. And then the state comes and says, you have a chance to give me your equipment into a holding clinic, we work on for you. It's just the same. And so we can't put down the GDR's history. But all this has nothing to do with health. Definitely not.
This is an historical question and address it mostly to André. The others also should feel free to answer. Having looked at a lot of history of Germany and Austria that has been produced in the last 25 or 30 years, it seems that the Germans and Austrians started every war since ancient times. And if you investigate some of the historiography more seriously, you discover that there are gaping holes in the evidence from the First World War on. There are situations in which both sides are blamed, the Germans and Austrians are exclusively to blame. Other wars, people attribute to them as the bad side. There's even one story told where there's a German-Hungarian war invented in the 1890s, and that's Germany's fault because they didn't see the fault of Germany. There never was. But the question is, are people supposed to believe this? Do historians believe their stories about German and Austrian real wars for early war, not just the Second World War, but early war that preceded the Second World War? Or is this something purely didactic, which we are pretending to believe because it would make us more virtuous Democrats?
This was the mentioned. It's not believed in the wider, by all the people. It doesn't interest them. But they know, as I said, from kindergarten on in schools, they know that, of course, only the Germans are capable of World War II. This is the point. This is an important question. The other thing is, of course, they are told World War I was caused by Germany too. But I think it doesn't interest
the last question.
Regarding the high system, I think a lot of what is happening is allowed to happen is due to a confusion in most people's mind, which is the confusion between highly controlled and the fact that it is state controlled by the service. It is possible to have control by giving money to them to pay for health insurance in the private sector. It is possible to have control by giving money to pay the whole in the private sector. But the state makes this confusion between the two, and they let people believe that in order to have control, you have to have a perfect private sector. And most of the problems described do not come from the fact that they have control, but they come from the fact that it is the public, it is the state that provides the service. So perhaps more emphasis should be put on the fact that the two things are different. Because the case for not having the voice is very hard to push. And the case for having a private sector with the state having the vote to get the private insurance is a lot easier to push.
This confusion you talk about inside people's head is always the mixture of what is the cause and what is the effect. Because if you even have a climate debate, we don't know which is first. The CO2 goes up, or the world gets warmer. And from what I learned is that first the world gets warmer, and then the CO2 gets up, and people mix it up. And it's very difficult for the health system to explain to normal people how they are directly puzzled by politics, because the system is willfully made so complex that nobody except lunatics and lawyers are able to understand the system. What we have to do is, this was one of the brain, one of the main aims of all those who deal with information is to get down from this complexity and to communicate that the state is not your friend within the health system, but the state destroys a good health provision, and that people understand this. And when they once understood this in their minds, they don't run after the wrong cause.
Thank you.